Okay, thank you very much, and thank you to the organizers for this invitation. So I've been fortunate to spend many periods in Kyoto, and a lot of mathematics that I'll be using today. Mathematics I've learned through Masaki, so I'm very grateful for his generosity in sharing mathematics. And that's Ethiopia now. So I will try to start with an example that I will come back to during my talk. So somehow, in the past 20, whatever, maybe not 20 years, but 15 years, I've been discussing similar topics. I've always used that same example. So there are other examples, but so I will start with trying to explain what's going on with what people call categorification. So I try to avoid that word because it's not always clear what is meant. So if you start with for now. Then you can use that as measuring dimensions of weight spaces, for instance, that you look at C2, you take the nth tensor power, so C2 as an action of SL2C, and inside you have an element H. And so you can decompose this according to the eigenvalues of H. So you can take the eigenspace where H acts by 2i minus n. And so the if you assign to a representation, a vector space with an action of H which has integer eigenvalues, the corresponding Laurent polynomial. You will get that on one hand, and here this is measured by by that coefficient. So you go from here to here by taking dimension. Dimension, graded dimension. So you can go one step further. By realizing that this representation of SL2C can be constructed geometrically, and maybe you look at that case, it's fairly trivial, it's just 2 points, and if you look at sheaves on that, you're going to get two copies of vector spaces, so there's not much going on. Let's say you take some base field, some field K as coefficients for your sheaves. So there's a sense in which this can be made in some sort of representation of a higher structure having to do with SL2C. And there's a sense in which you can take a tensor product of those things. So I'll put a double tensor. So word Y, I don't want to write just a simple tensor in that case. And this is going to split, that's a fact, as a direct sum of depends if you do it abelian or derived, but category of Bever sheaves, say smooth on orbits for Borel on Grassmannians. So if you pass to Grothendieck groups, the Grothendieck group there will give you this, and the action, the categorical action of SL2C will give you the normal action. And the Grothendieck group there is going to be this weight space. So so here.
What did you write on the subscript of Perl?
B smooth. So I think I take the upper triangular matrices in GLN and I take Perl sheaves for the stratification of the orbits. So we've gone up the categorical level. So we started with numbers can be viewed somehow as -1 categories. sets as zero categories, and now this is a category of modules.
And this respects the test of the tree structure is
the usual. I mean, you can take it's maybe you could take derived categories of constructible sheets in some sense. That's really what you find, and then inside you. Kind of canonical basis, picture, or crystal basis rather, picture which allows you to pick a test structure. So I've been discussing these things some way before. So what I would like to explain today is that actually you can go to infinity there by actually giving a meaning to really an action of SL2C on those varieties, I mean, or there. So there's a sense in which you take 2 points and you view some sort of action of SL2C. On that, you can take a tensor power of that. So I'm not sure in general what this is, some sort of generalized, something a bit more general than higher stacks, a bit bigger setting. But this is going to split. really, as a it's a co-product of Grassmannians.
So the category of perversives in question is itself simple.
This category of perversives here on Grassmannians is not semi-simple.
So how can it be just vector spaces or something?
Yes, because this is not the tensor power, the normal tensor power. That's exactly the point. So thanks for pointing that out. So if you start with something semi-simple. The usual categorical algebraic constructions, it's difficult to imagine that you will be able to construct something non-semi-simple. But the point is that when you're doing this tensor product, somehow you're keeping track of the fact that there is an action of SL2C, so there's some kind of lax phenomena appearing there, and that gives rise to something non-semi-simple. Okay, so I'll get back to that theme that this kind of higher representation theory is a way to construct interesting categories from boring ones. Yes?
Is Grassmannian below in the sutures of what?
I don't know. I will explain. So I'll tell you how I can make sense of that at the level of varieties, or less, so as good as it gets. But I'm not sure if it's reasonable in general, so I'm not sure if it should be viewed as a bit more up to homotopy or in a, you know, some sort of stratified homotopy A1. Multivic way or what, so I don't know. But you can make sense of that, I'll explain that, and in general, so I don't know what is the right category of geometric object. And so it's here, it's taking some sort of category of Schiff. So I will explain, what it means that SL2C somehow acts there, and then I'll get to that point. So first, I will maybe say quick things about motivations. For higher representation theory. So the idea, point of the talk is that one would like to do things like that with a more complicated moduli spaces, okay. Maybe not just Grassmannians or flag varieties, queer varieties, but more things associated maybe to more complicated fields or associated just to moduli spaces on sheaves or on some varieties, so it doesn't have to be. So that's the motivation. Anyway, so the original motivation for this higher representation theory, the idea one should do something like that is, first one is low-dimensional topology. So that's Kren and Frankel, 94, and they coined the term categorification back then. So, well, there was a so you take G, say, complex semi-simple V algebra, and out of G together with maybe. I mean, quantization, maybe specialization at root affinity or not, now it's less clear, but back then, so you can construct out of modules over the quantum group, you can construct invariants of three-dimensional manifold. So the gadget called TQFT, and that will be in dimension three. So that's a work of Rechtekin, Tourayev, and Witten. Or Witten, Rechtekin, Tourayev. Witten was a different, maybe non-mathematical approach. And in some sense, if you start with just G modules, Witten, Rechtekin, Tourayev, with G modules, you would get a field theory in dimension two. And so the idea of Krenn-Fenkel was that, if you were to act not just on vector spaces or some kind of Q vector spaces, if we were to make sense of acting on categories, by increasing the categorical level by one, you would increase the dimension of the field theory by one. G. So that was the proposal of Krenn and Fenkel. It turned out that it took some time to find out what that means. And then, one motivation that came later is moduli spaces. So it's still. So there is some evidence that this works. There are theories, not theories, due to Kovanov and others, particular Kovanov-Ronzonski, that have to do with four-dimensional field theories. And that are known to arise from that kind of algebraic theory. So moduli spaces, so if you take maybe X a variety, or maybe a category, you can look at some something like some moduli space of objects. You can look at some Hilbert scheme or sheaves, moduli space of sheaves with certain properties. Then you can take, eventually you can take something like a K-theory or maybe just a Euler characteristic. In between, you could take some category of sheaves on them. And these constructions can lead to interesting invariants of the original variety or category. And you can, maybe some obvious construction like that in something very concrete would be constructions like Donaldson and Thomas. For invariants of Calabi-Yau's manifolds. So the idea is that there's not just one moduli space, but lots of moduli spaces. And representation theory has been coming in to understand those invariants. And those Grothendieck groups often have carried interesting representations of interesting algebras. So representation theory, some more helps. Or should help control those. So one of the many examples that turn out to be coming from representation theory itself, but a typical example where it's not like that would be starting with C2 and taking Hilbert schemes of points of C2 on C2 or a surface. So in that case, work of Nakajima, Kondoskis shows that using action of Heisenberg algebra, an Heisenberg algebra, you can understand cohomology, or maybe of cohomology of your variety. Okay. So the idea is that so that's what classically was done. So two representation theory. So here you would want construct representations of some algebras by taking many moduli spaces and using correspondences, sort of Hecker correspondences. But the idea is that those correspondences have a geometric origin, so they will act already in on categories of sheaves, but it's not just the correspondences themselves, as you'll see, have avant-domorphisms. And here you should really have some sort of infinity representation. So infinity is in the sense that so why the number 2 here, so there it was a 1. If you take all representations of an algebra, that's a 1 category, that's a category. If you take categories acted on by something, it's going to form a 2 category. And here, should involve things like topological spaces, so infinity or infinity one categories.
You write left acting on H, cohomology, chain theory.
So that what I mean is that you there are those examples where you take various moduli spaces, you take the direct sum of their K-theory or cohomology groups, and you have interesting algebras acting on that, representations of various structures on that. Okay.
That's where the letter is chi, no?
Chi would be, well, let me remove that. You could do one more step and take just some sort of Euler characteristic. For example, in Donaldson-Thomas theory, that's what you want. You want the Euler characteristic only of your moduli spaces. Okay. But you use you still would like to use representation theory somehow to understand this and eventually to see that as coming from some sort of character formula. Okay, so yeah, the idea is that the original idea was to try to control these categories. So for examples coming from within representation theory, we're dealing with very concrete moduli spaces. So okay, maybe it's not a surprise. I mean, they were built for representation theory, but the belief is that you should be able to do that much more generally. So that's one aspect. And the other aspect is that using some sort of abstract higher representation theory, you can construct new sort of geometric objects, which would be maybe less less obvious or less like schemes or derived schemes. And so maybe they exist for more general, so new geometrical object. So what's okay, for example, would be things like flag varieties. There are things that like that that do work for quiver varieties. I mentioned those. So these have to do with algebraically closed fields. So you can try to hope that there are things, the objects of geometric Langlands, which are more like affinization of those there, will also be treatable like that. And then you can, well, you can be very hopeful. And you can continue on the queue, et cetera. So put more question marks. So you could hope, if you're at the most ambitious aspect, that you could even define things more general than Shimura varieties, why not, over Q, by using some sort of formal some formal machinery. So for now, I don't know much about what's going on even there. So. Or Stukas. But it looks like Stukas shouldn't be too far from that. Okay, so. So I'll say a few words about geometric representation theory from one point of view. So I have a complex semi-simple Lie algebra G. I'll take let's say gamma Dynkin diagram. And if you choose an orientation of the edges, you obtain now a quiver, and you can look at representations, finite dimensional representations of that quiver, and make a moduli space, moduli stack. Let me write stack for one time, but say now, of representations of the quiver. So it's something very concrete. Start with this, you can, well, maybe like this, you can maybe choose this orientation. And the representation of the quiver is just putting a vector space here, vector space here, you fix them, and then you look at space of maps, just a vector space, from here to here, space of map of there to there, and you divide by the action of the general linear groups at each vertex. Okay, so you get that, and so let me let moduli stack maybe M. And what's happening? So that's let's say Ringo and Lustig is that if you look at the K0 of mixed perverse sheaves on M, this is there's a convolution, and this is isomorphic as an algebra to the quantum, the positive part of the quantum group associated to G. Okay, so like, your quantum group comes anyway with a positive negative part.
And what is G in this case?
So G is a complex semi-simple Lie algebra. Okay. You can extend to Katz movie.
To do with the Dynkin diagram.
It's the same of it's a Dynkin diagram of for G. Yes. Yes. So that's point one, and then point two is if you fix lambda dominant weight, so vertex set I, you can associate a variety, symplectic variety M, let's I have a name already, so let's call it X lambda. So that's a Nakajima, queer variety. So this is would be typically called a, I mean could be called a queer variety, and that one Nakajima queer variety. So that's a Honnes variety. And so that variety lives inside inside a moduli space of representation of frame of the frame double quiver. So the idea is that your lambda there needs to be used. And so, for example, if you start with this diagram, so you double the arrows, so it doesn't depend on the choice of an annotation anymore, and the framing is adding one vertex for each existing vertex, maps like this. So you look at representations of that quiver where now as those vertices, you fix the vector spaces, say k to the lambda 1, k to the lambda 2, k to the lambda 3. And it's an open subspace by specifying certain stability conditions. So there are also some conditions on the composition of arrows, but importantly, the stability conditions, which says that when you want something like those maps going down to be injective, much more subtle version of that. And so you have this variety, and on that variety, on the K theory of that variety, this is the grand K theory of X lambda, you're going to get an action of UQ of G. So that's a Nakajima's construction, and this is simple, this realizes, maybe you can sort of see. A simple representation of simple representation, say L of lambda, the Q version. So you can realize the quantum analog of the simple finite dimensional representation with iOS weight lambda. You can realize it in the K theory of a quiver of a Nakajima quiver variety.
What mean K is index?
There's an action. No. It's equivalent. Yes, equivalent.
In the first result, you mentioned about mixed perverse sheaves.
Yes.
If the mix is relative, you are doing something characteristic Peter.
Or you, I mean, mixed Hodge modules either way. Yes.
And the Q, the Q doesn't have to do with it. Okay.
So the Q here has nothing to do. Is either it's to do with the Frobenius or it's to do with just Hodge
structure.
Sorry.
Q here is a variable.
Q is a variable, okay. Yes.
Nothing to do with it.
No. It has to do if you do the Ringel approach where you do, you count, you look at constructible functions. Yes, that I should have, probably that if you put cohomology, it's not right. So, no, I put only the C star equivalent. Still too big. It's a quantum affine thing that acts, yes. So, okay. Let's put included there. There, yes, thanks. Okay, so the example there. So for SL2, the picture simplifies a lot because the variety there is a cotangent bundle, and the cotangent bundle of a Grassmannian. So what's going on is that so for SL2, so the quiver gamma is okay. Gamma is just that. So moduli space of representations is just middle of BGR. BGR ends, BGR maybe R's. And if you take your weight lambda, x lambda, it's going to be the union of bxn of gr and of I. And the action of, sorry, it's a cotangent bundle of xn. Sorry, is equal to cotangent. And the action of UQ of G comes from correspondences. Okay, here I'll repeat this. So if you take a whatever cohomology theory you take, you can pull back and then push forward.
On the top, you have a flag manifold.
I'm sorry? So these are flag, yeah, these are, say, in C to the N, where dimension of L is I, and L prime is I plus 1, and these are the two projection maps. So you have, you can pull back, push forward. So this will give you something going, say, from the, let's say, cohomology. Let me switch to cohomology. It doesn't matter. And so these will induce an action. Well, if you do it on K-theory, I don't want to be, there are various versions. You can realize an action of G, UQ of G, or Jungian. There are various versions. You can realize like that. But geometrically, it comes from that correspondence. So that's something, in that case, that's order in general. You have to do it in the cotangent, really in the cotangent bundle or some technique.
Part, or?
So here, you have only a positive part. And the fact that you have the positive part coming from M, and this somehow leaves over M, means that this positive part will act there. You can see it. But now the miracle is that the negative part will come as somehow looking at the same kernel, but in the reverse way, or some, there'll be just adjoint functor. So instead of going this way, you go that way, and you get the Fi. So this will give you your generator small e of SL2. And if you want F, you just look at your correspondence the other way around. And that's what happens here as well. Right, so now let me start talking about two representations. So the idea is that in this type of geometrical construction, so you have realized your operators as coming from correspondences. These correspondences, you can use them as also inducing functors between categories of sheaves. And so that's one classical fact, just to do some more categorification. But really what we realized with Schwang is that these correspondences themselves, they come with endomorphisms. That's really where the algebraic structure is hidden. Okay, so strong. So you replace. So when you look at representations of G, you replace vector spaces by, say, abelian, for example, or triangulated categories. And say EI becomes EI, say, an endo functor. cetera, FIs. And so that's a some kind of something that had been observed repeatedly. And there's more structure. These come actually with endomorphisms, with natural transformation. And then there is also some sort of co-operator. So somehow you have a, if you think of your correspondences as being some echo operators, these echo operators themselves, they will have between themselves echo operators. Okay. So first, each of those EIs, when you realize it, it should come with a prescribed endomorphism. This should come with, they should be maps like this when you have an I and a J, and they should satisfy certain echo relations. So that somehow in type A or affine A. And in general, it's a quiver Hecker relations. And it's things that have been developed by Kovanov, Lodar, and Serf. So that's a generalization outside type A. So it would be an affine Hecker relation. So you can think of that, of the Xi's and the T's as satisfying affine Hecker algebra relations. But that would work only if your algebra has is SLN, or if you generalize to Kac-Moody SLN hat. In general, you need some new kind of finite algebra. So. Right, so you do that, so and then, so they should satisfy relation, and you also need to do some localization that will enforce in a categorical way. You invert certain maps which express the relations that the commutators between an EI and an FJ. Okay, EI and FJ commute, unless I equals J, in which case, it's something so that you specify maps that will realize such an isomorphism, and you require that map to be invertible. Okay, so in this example here, there is two representation of SL2 on the union of Grassmannians, of those Grassmannians. On the union of coherent sheaves, so. So you take as a category, let me do it with maybe the Dirac categories. So I've been lying actually, this is not true there, I'm sorry. Oh no, that's no, this is correct. Yeah, that's correct. No. So let me take as a category constructible sheaves on the Grassmannians with some coefficients. So you could specify a stratification, or you could take an equivalent with respect to a Borel, in which case the Grotoni group will be of reasonable of the right size. That's what you is the rough category of what we're there. So on that, there is a two representation of SL2. So when you need to specify endo functors, and well, I should have put class in the Grotoni group or class homology of that. If you view this now as a functor, then I mean, take the Dirac functor, then this will give you what you want. So E is well, is the same thing. It's Q star P star. Okay, take a sheaf there, pull back, push forward. And now the interesting thing is that in this two representation structure, it's not just about the functors, but it's about natural transformations, and the natural transformation that you will the endomorphism of E. Is something that is the first term class of the tautological line bundle there. Okay, so R. Viewed as an element of say H2 of this GR and I plus one. Now if you have an element in the cohomology of your correspondence. This defines an endomorphism of E, or maybe a graded endomorphism, okay? Goes from E to E shifted by 2. And then there is a T. The T comes from fact that if you do a correspondence like this twice, you have a GR I plus 1, I plus 2, which is there's a P1 fibration to GR I plus 2. And this P1 fibration, you need some endomorphism there, and that's true with P1 or P1 mod mode Borel, and that comes from on P1 that comes from taking the top class and taking the dual of capping with the top class. Goes down. And you'll be back to. Right, so that's some old story, just with a small refinement. And the point about doing these refinements is that there is some interesting representation theory. And so if I go back there, so there is a classification, there's a notion of simple two representation. So instead of having vector spaces, you have now categories, L of lambda, and there are things like Jordan Hölder, for example. So if you have something of category of reasonable size with a two representation, you can write it as an extension of those categories, tensors, some multiplicity category. And this category L lambda can be realized algebraically. I mean, by hand, somehow, as some sort of quotient of a Verma module, or and that relies on the Kong Kashiwa's work, or on the as some sort of sheets on the Nakajima quiver varieties. You have to do small variation of the construction. So the fact that you have two constructions of those somehow tells you that this algebraic construction will be out of things like Hecker algebras, so-called cyclotomic quiver algebras. So these are perverse sheaves, some sense on some varieties. And the fact that you have these two realizations tells you there will be an equivalence of categories. And that's one of those things that tell you that will tell you that you can compute decomposition numbers, simple modules, etc. Characters are simple modules for your finite dimensional algebras. So it's a typical result of geometric representation theory. You have some finite dimensional algebras, maybe you want to compute, say something about their simple modules, where you say that category is equivalent to category of perverse sheaves. Then you can use whatever, decomposition theorem or something to compute those. But this arises from the fact that both are endowed with a structure of two representation. And once you know that, once you know it's simple, you just have somehow to identify the highest weights, and you immediately know that you have an equivalence. It's a very cheap way of proving an equivalence. Okay, so yes, so last thing about two representation before I move to infinity is that you can construct. So the original motivation of Krell and Frenkel for trying to do something like that, to get a field theory, the crucial ingredient is a tensor product. So here you can tensor G modules. Here the tensor product is interesting, but one more interesting is the R matrix. But here somehow the tensor product is already very interesting. The reason why I write it with a double circle, I will now explain. So you can do tensor products. Of two representations. So if you have V and V prime, so there will be categories with this with endo functors with some extra structure. Then this you will associate something like that, but this is this as a category. You need it depends on does not depend only on V and V prime as categories. So the forgetful functor from two representations to categories does not commute with tensor products. Okay, let's say abelian categories or whatever reasonable categories on which you can do tensor products. So it's fine, but that's not this tensor product you're doing. You're doing something more complicated, and that's apparent in the discussion in the mark of Alfred Gaber earlier, is that if you take tensor powers of that category, you get something semi-simple. Whereas if you do it viewing this category as having this extra structure, you're getting something more interesting. Yes?
You do a homotopy tensor product?
So it's defined on the nose, not up to homotopy. But there are difficulties with that, is that you have to move to an infinity setting, so that's all. So the problem is that the category itself is defined on the nose, but the action, the functors are defined on the nose, but the action, the x and the t's, the x's, sorry, they are not. They are not natural transformations in the usual sense. They are only in the infinity sense. That's where things. So there is something of two homotopy there, and somehow that suggests that. There are problems with this theory. I mean, there are difficulties, maybe. And somehow moving to some more infinity categories, topological, or more geometric framework is probably a good idea. So I should say the reason why we developed that with Schwang was not for anything I've mentioned so far. We are not even aware of Krein-Frankel. It was to solve problems in representation theory. So there are certain equivalences of Dirac categories that were conjectured for representations of symmetric groups or general linear groups. So that was our original motivation. There are more recent uses, for example, for cohomology of Nakajima quiver varieties. That's much closer to what I explained about moduli spaces. And variants of those, so that's a work of Shan, Varagnolo, Vastro. So some of the theory has been driven by, to some extent by topology, but it hasn't been very successful so far because it's hard to go to construct field theory, to construct invariants of four-dimensional manifold, and by representation theory and geometry. And that's an example of a bit similar to the case of Hilbert schemes of points of C2 on surface, but it's now more complicated framed, for example, bundles. Okay, so now I'll move to infinity. So all of that, one of my motivations, for example, here is that, you want to understand, for example, Dolasson-Thomas theory, these moduli spaces are not just varieties. I mean, the obstruction theory, whatever, so there are spaces, so it's not so easy to just even get their Euler characteristic. And the idea was somehow that you could maybe use these categories of sheaves maybe as some sort of algebraic structures and deal with that and somehow avoid, you could maybe get them directly out of your variety, avoiding passing through the moduli space. That's been one of the developments. So for example, you can get the category of sheaves on Nakajima quiver varieties. Somehow you can get it without constructing the quiver variety just by saying it's L of lambda. That was motivation, but what I realized more recently is that it's maybe not getting rid of the geometry is maybe not what one should do, but rather do representation theory on a geometrical object instead of vector spaces. Okay, so that's it. Part or infinity. So the idea is to somehow view. Grassmannians themselves as being some sort of and some object which have symmetries which are controlled by something. So I should say there's maybe a number, so I will say space. I will call something a space, so I don't know what that should be. So that should be something that should be at least something like infinity stacks, but or maybe some extended version of, you need a little, that's not quite right, or you need maybe stratified, say topological spaces, if you put that, you could use topological spaces just up to homotopy. Something like that seems to be reasonable, but it's not quite right, seemingly, either. So the problem is you need to do some different kind of gluing, but it seems you also need to do maybe also some sort of micro-localizations. So I don't know. So for example, these Nakajima quiver varieties are not cotangent bundles, but maybe there are ways still to think of them as some sort of Cotangent model or something. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. But that's okay. So the starting point would be some category, maybe Abelian or triangulated. And to that, you would want to associate some lithoretic structure. So I'll say a little more about that at the very end. Let me start just for now being a little bit vague. So I take M, the moduli space, space meaning just here higher stack, so moduli of objects of C. So category would be a K-linear category as well, or maybe you work over the sphere spectrum.
Formally, it's a
higher step. Yes, maybe an Abelian K-linear category, and this would be a higher stack, yes. Try to be more precise, but there are the difficulties come right after that. There is still good, there are good definitions. M2 would be the moduli of the exact sequences, or maybe a triangle. So I'll stop there. You need a little more. And so when you have a reasonable category, you can try to make some whole algebra out of that category. So it's an algebra with basis isomorphism classes of objects, and the multiplication has to do with extensions and counting how many extensions you can do. That involves these two things. So you can directly work with this and look for X a space. So infinity representation in that case, that of X a space, and of a correspondence from X to X for each object of C. So that means you would have put it all in one row. So you have a correspondence from X to X parameterized by M. And then you want some associativity, in the fact that the action is, this has some sort of multiplication, a convolution. So the compatibility would be that so that's very simplified statement, but that's essentially what the structure is. So it's not extremely new in some sense, and people have thought of things I think similar to that. So in this setting here, we can do that construction. So
do you really need isomorphism or just morphism?
Isomorphism. Yes, I need isomorphism. It's saying that if you have some sort of G times H times X is GH times X. So here, by applying E, you do a first action, second action, and this is coalescing the product.
What do you mean by the fiber?
So it's a middle there. It's a you have a map to M, the middle. I mean, there are three maps, but I'm using the one, the middle object. And everything should be, this should be over. This is over X times M times X. This is over, sorry, there are two M's left, one and three, so it should be compatible. But anyway, there are other compatibilities I'm not writing. And there's a difficulty there because everything is infinity. You should, compatibility doesn't mean, it's not that a diagram commutes, it's that there is an additional data that's expressing the compatibility. So the example there, yes, so, let me give. So we've seen it's BGLN. So in the example, and if we take X as the Grassmannian on an n-dimensional vector space, so you can go from GRN of say I. And in the middle, I mean, over that variety, you have a vector bundle of rank R. So the same as the map to BGL R. Okay. So that's the structure. So over that, I have having a bundle of rank R is the same as having this map to BGL R. And so there are obvious compatibilities. So this is this structure satisfies the axioms it should satisfy, and gives an example of some things which would be an infinity representation of SL2. So this category is the one we constructed starting with the quiver with one point. So here, C would be the category of K-modules. If you take K-modules, these are representations of a quiver which is just one point. And so that's what you get. Yes, and what I should explain somehow is that you can do tensor products as well in settings. So first, these things say that many moduli spaces arising from the category C, so C could be coherent sheaves of a variety, or could be the category of algebraic origin. And all those moduli spaces that you would want to consider, they should be viewed as some sort of representations of this fixed algebraic structure you have stated to your category. And then you can do representation theory to analyze those moduli spaces. So I'll try to explain the last point, why the tensor power there works. So proposition, so can define. So there's a candidate for a tensor product. So if you take two spaces with this extra data, you can try to do, you can define something that, if representable in a certain sense, would be a tensor product. So there's a problem of which category to work with. So unfortunately, I mean, it's not, in this infinity categorical setting, it's not exactly something being representable. It's a little more complicated, so I don't know yet. But there are cases where there is one can construct an object and check that it's somehow, it gives this. So if there is a right category, I mean, this one can define something which is unique. And so the proposition in this example, I'd like to explain, is that if you take this is isomorphic to justify this description there. The inductive step is there. So I'd like to explain what's going on geometrically here. And so the idea is that if you think of a representation of SL2, you can view it as a map from C2 V is a representation of SL2. It's the same as a map from C2 tensor V to C2 tensor V. So to be given a representation of SL2 has to do with doing something with the C2 tensor V. Okay. So the same is happening there. In this case of SL2, the fact that this is endowed with a two representation is really having to do actually with that. And with the fact that, yeah, there's some sort of gluing process. So let me try to maybe put a quick diagram. So you have, I will look at only the BGL1 part of M, somehow generates all of M, the convolution. So, so we start with that, so we can write down the total space of the bundle. Okay, so that's an A1 fibration, C fibration. This would be a projective space of dimension n minus I minus 1, projective space of dimension I, dual projective space. So, okay, with that, we can look at the complement of the zero section. And now the line bundle here is ample for that projective map. So we can take the corresponding vector bundle there. So forget the G or I plus, as we see, n minus I inside the complement of the zero section. will be isomorphic to that. And the bundle, this Lie bundle is anti-impole for this. We can construct similarly. And then we have the complement of the zero section inside. And that's isomorphic to that. Okay, so I've started with my correspondence together with its Lie bundle, and that's how I constructed that. Right, so now you look at GR, the GR n plus 1 I plus 1. Inside, you have a closed subvariety. So the spaces, so if you see n plus 1 as Cn plus 0. And this is isomorphic to Gn I plus 1. And the complement is a bundle over Gr and I. So you take an L, L intersected with Cn. And now this bundle is actually isomorphic to the bundle we have here. So at least this so we have decomposed this Grassmannian as closed subvariety, open subvariety, which are things that come from here. So now to really glue, we need to consider the normal bundle to this, and that's let me write n. The n there, the normal bundle, is actually isomorphic to that one there. Okay. And so for the gluing, we need to find to prescribe an open subset of the common open subset of those, I mean the intersection. And the intersection is precisely there. So we realize that this variety there has a up to homotopy, at least, is going to be GRN I plus 1. But it's really, we've really done that at the level of varieties, not just spaces of two homotopies. So that's what's going on with the tensor product in that case, okay? So this is, in general, you have to, what you will see is some sort of colimit involving, here just a co-equalizer. You have this space, and this. So that comes formally from those constructions. So I'd like to finish so there are things similar to that that happen for quiver varieties, but not. Isn't quite it's not quite clear yet what objects you get. So so I'd like to get back to what kind of structure really is it that we are representing when we have a category C. And so it's something that's a little bit like a group, or rather a quantum group, but an infinity categorical version. And one can hope that it's actually interesting as an invariant of the category. So if we start with our category C, one can construct something. So the problem is, that does it have the right properties? I mean, so let me put a global question mark. Something like an infinity group. So the data involving m, m2, and higher m3, m4 are higher versions and lots of compatibility. Is something that looks like a group, except that there are many things that differ, but it's not quite commutative, not quite co-commutative. Some sort of infinity group, let me write it M of C. And that should have, that should be an interesting invariant that acts on all moduli spaces. And that it would be a bit like a reductive group with whatever it means, with weight lattice being the K-theory spectrum. it should be also something that it should act on moduli spaces. It should have some kind of a vial or building combinatorics related to the space of stability condition. So let's say C is triangulated. And more generally, so this would be a bit like you think of K-theory as being, say, maybe your torus or weight lattice. So there is more stuff, and the K-theory is additive on the extensions of categories. It's a universal additive invariant. So this will not be, it will behave more multiplicative, like it will behave multiplicatively. And so if you have an exact sequence of categories, that should lead to a parabolic subgroup. With the Levy M of C1 times of C2, M of C2. And so, I mean, you still want, I mean, you want to compare the K-theory spectra, that is a vibration. So you would want to compare this M of C to M of C1 and M of C2. Well, the way you could do that is by looking at this quotient M of C modulo P, which would be some sort of parabolic flag variety. And you could hope that this is controlled by some sort of parabolic version of the space of stability condition. So yeah, probably I should stop there. So there is some object that seems to arise from reasonable categories. So the part that something like the K-theory spectrum should come, something that arises in work of Dikerov and Kapranov. They have some version of whole algebra that contains, so it's more Waldhausen type K-theory. Here it looks more like a plus construction. But anyway, so yeah, hope that says something like that. Okay, I'll stop here. Thank you.
These categories C, which you are talking about, are kind of as you want to be three Calabi-Yau or
no? That's the problem. Is that you want a nice category, but anything?
Yeah, and yeah, and also I have the kind of feeling that when you want to speak about stratified space, yeah, and categorical stratified space, and want to glue it, get some more exotic things, the right language will be the skeletal Lagrangian skeleton, which will not.
So that's exactly it seems to be the right way to think of. Some kind of downstairs version of
some kind of not related to Scotland bundle.
Yes, exactly. Yes. So, but is there a derived version of that, or can you do something for derived? Because the moduli space that comes, there will be more like higher stacks. So, yes. Thank you.
Other questions?
So in the cohomology of Hilbert schemes on surface, the multiplicative structure make Virasoro algebra appears. Do you have a categorical version of this?
Okay, so this is very hard. This part very little has been understood from this higher point of view. Everything is Katz Moody and the affinization is missing. But it seems that in this very general setting, there seems to be also a vertex algebra approach. So when you construct your group, anyway, affinization should occur, but there should be seems to be a way to define some sort of vertex operators. So you have to do something quite radical. You have to look at imagine your category scalinar. You have to start by looking at nonlinear functor from your category, say 2k modules. You start with that sort of polynomial functor, so that's big. That's kind of exponentiating your category. And then on that, you can do you can do some convolutions. So you can think of your category as some sort of categorical Fock space, and then you have some sort of Heisenberg algebra. And then you can it's possible that in some cases it's like that. When you derive the action by convolution of operators like the Heisenberg algebra, there will be vertex operators deriving in the sense of homotopic algebra. You have to go. to do simply Schrödinger wrenching. So then, yeah, they should be in there. They should be. I don't know where Virasoro lies there, but it should be. There should be some conformal structure.
Any other questions or comments?
So the tensor product has a Jordan holder filtration by simple modules. Can you see this geometrically?
Yes, that's true. That part, yes, I didn't even thought of that. Yes, geometrically, it's I mean, there's something going on geometrically, which is the stratification. So things will be. So you can see. It's not quite like that actually. No. So you see stratification, but they are not. There are some. It's something else. So that aspect is more about. Thinking of already there's a problem with T-structure, so you can do the theory with Dirac categories, triangulated categories, and inside you have to say, oh, there's a T-structure. So it's like going from a tensor product of representations to saying, well, there's some crystal theory that gives a nice basis in the tensor product. So that's what you need to do for the categories. But if you move to this infinity setting, already there, I don't know what it would mean to. When you construct this tensor product, it's one of the difficulties. It's not clear what object it should be in general. But in the good cases, it is a space, and that's like picking a T-structure. So that would be the first step for answering your question. It's like you already need to look at maybe. You could ask it in the Dirac setting. But no, I don't know. Geometrically, I haven't looked at that.